Well, for more on the impact these floods are having on our farmers and in turn our groceries, we're joined by Catherine Valicia, Managing Director of Valicia Farm in Victoria. Catherine, good morning to you. Thanks for your time this morning. Really appreciate it. Look, you've been doing this, your family's been doing this a long time, like a lot of decades now. What damage do you think we'll see from the floods and how will that affect prices?
Oh, look, it's hard to tell, like Jim spoke earlier. It's hard to tell what damage actually has been done until the waters recede. From a produce point of side of things, I think, you know, kind of the states like Shepparton and those areas will have a bit of a damage along the fruit lines and zucchinis in particular. We might see a bit of fluctuation. Okay. But overall, yeah, it is a bit hard to tell. But from a fresh produce perspective, I don't think it'll be dire.
Okay, that is good news. I mean, because at the end of the day, when we hear these things, this is why we want to talk to the people who are on the ground. We don't know exactly how it's going to affect them. Harvesting is always an issue with all this water around, isn't it? And so that's going to be an issue. But you're saying zucchinis at the moment. Anything else that you can think of?
Yeah, well, again, a lot of the fruit won't be picked yet. So, again, we don't know what the damage is that's done. It'll be on the trees. But I think, again, with fresh produce, there's always the opportunity to buy something else that is, you know, not as expensive. So that's our tip always, to try to be a bit flexible with your purchases and to manage the budget. But I think the key thing that needs to be addressed also, a lot of this conversation gets spoken about the food prices and the changing food prices. We're just an outcome, again, of all these other inflationary pressures. And those are the key pressures that need to be addressed, both for household spending, but also for us as growers to help maintain enough money to buy produce and meat and grains and everything else.
Okay, so I want to ask you about that. Look, you pride yourself, your company prides yourself on having a really skilled workforce. Even getting workers in some parts of the country is hard enough. What are some of the things that are going to alleviate the pressures on you in order to get us cheaper goods?
Well, obviously, a skilled workforce is key for every industry, and we're not alone in the shortage there. So that needs to be looked at, especially by government. But the other thing I think that really is what really hurts families in particular is how much their mortgages or rent takes out of their budget. And then that conversation gets filtered down to affordable food. Australia has some of the most affordable food in the world. We grow three times as much food than we need. So there's no food shortage.
Yeah.
But the fact is that our budgets for food is getting smaller and smaller and eaten away by other things like electricity, obviously rents and mortgages, like I said, fuel. So those are the key things that need to be addressed. Because again, like I said, food prices is really just an outcome. We're struggling as much as any household to try to keep our budgets in alignment.
You're really articulating the issue as well. Just before we go, La Nina, I think everyone is, or most people are sick of it. Are you?
Sick of a lot of things, but we don't have enough time to go through that. I'm sure like every other Australian, we're all sick of a lot of things between COVID, blood, drought. It doesn't end. I think, look, climate change is something that's going to be here with us, fluctuating weather. We just need to be a bit resilient, and there's always good value fresh produce out there, so don't cut that off the budget. I implore everyone.
All right.
Keep it in the shopping
cart. Really good to talk to you. I think your family's been doing it 70 years. Appreciate you being on today. And look, on Friday, we're going to devote the whole show to whatever grievances you have.
Thank you.
Good on you, Catherine. Thank you.
Well, while Victoria faces the brunt of the flooding emergency, the ripples will reach far and wide. The Treasurer warning all our budgets will be hit. And Jim Chalmers joins us now from Canberra. Nice to see you this morning, Treasurer. I feel like we need a bit of Tim's namaste, don't we? There's a bit going on at the moment.
Yeah, good morning, Ali. There is a bit going on right now. It feels like the hits keep coming in lots of ways. And I think, as we spoke about last week when I was in DC, you know, some of these communities are getting absolutely smashed by these natural disasters. And our focus is primarily on the human element of that, what it means for people in these affected communities. But there will be an impact on the economy as well, and there will be an impact on grocery prices. We're talking here about some of the best farmland in the world producing some of the world's best food. And obviously, when it goes underwater, there's a lot of crops and a lot of livestock at risk. And so we'll learn more about the economic impact of what's happening here. But our primary focus, as it should be, is what it means for people in those communities. People are there for each other when times are tough, and the government will be there for them as well.
Well, let's just start, because there's a bit to get through. Let's talk first about assistance for flood victims. Besides the emergency payments, what assistance is on offer? And after what we saw in northern New South Wales, where there were such delays in getting access to money because of red tape, what's being done to fix that?
Well, the emergency payments are crucial. You know, we get them out the door as soon as we can. And I know my colleague Murray Watt's been working closely with us and with the Prime Minister to make sure that those payments can flow as quickly as possible. But as always, if there's more that can be responsibly done, obviously we consider that. You know, we think it's an important role of government to be there when times are tough, when things like this happen. There are payments which kick in, which are already kicking in. There's obviously going to be a big bill associated with rebuilding some of these communities, and we'll be there for people in that regard as well. But, you know, right across the board, right across the country, in every affected area, whatever we can responsibly do, we'll do.
And this is it, isn't it? We've seen this too many times over the past couple of years. We know what is involved, what's ahead in rebuilding and getting these communities back and people back in their homes. I was reading this morning too, you've got dairy farmers forced to dump milk because trucks can't get in. Crops have been lost. How high do you expect grocery prices to go?
Well, first of all, we need to recognise that it's heartbreaking for these primary producers, for these farmers, whether it's dairy, whether it's livestock, whether it's crops that can't be accessed now or need to be ploughed into the ground or lost under floodwaters. You know, we need to understand that it's heartbreaking for people, and often where people do it the toughest is when the floodwaters recede. It's tough right now when the water's up. We know we've got some more heavy weather later in the week coming as well. But we need to recognise that it's tough for people in an ongoing way. There are mental health consequences as well as economic consequences. When it comes to the cost of living, you know, we have seen this before, unfortunately, when it comes to crops, most recently in southeast Queensland, not far from me, where we saw prices in our supermarkets go up because we lost so much of that season's crop. And that's what we're facing again. We don't yet know what the full impact will be on the cost of living. We don't yet know how many billions of dollars this flood and its recovery will cost. I've already had preliminary conversations with Treasury about this, but it's premature to put a final number on it for obvious reasons. We're still counting the costs and assessing the damage, but there will be a substantial impact on the cost of living. There will be a substantial impact on the budget, and there's no use pretending otherwise.
Okay, so going to that then, we know this is all going to have add to inflationary pressures. You're talking about the cost of living increases that we're going to see here as well. What in next week's budget will address that?
Well, we've got a responsible cost of living plan, which goes to things like cheaper childcare, cheaper medicines, getting wages moving again, paid parental leave implemented in a staged way. But we've been pretty upfront with people and said that what we don't want to do, and we've seen this overseas, is provide cost of living relief in a way that just creates more inflation and pushes interest rates up higher than they would otherwise be. You know, we've got to walk a pretty tight line here between doing what we can to provide that cost of living relief with an economic dividend in a way that doesn't push up inflation versus spending money in an untargeted way. It's not an easy balance to strike, but we're trying to strike it for the right economic reasons. We want to provide that cost of living relief, but we don't want it to be counterproductive.
Well, the farms in Victoria too have been smashed, crops damaged and dairy farmers without electricity. Now we hear that this will impact the cost of groceries around the country, all inflationary pressures, yeah. Jason.
Yeah, well, you've got people who've lost everything. There's still people out there, Carl, that are isolated or are being evacuated right now. And so you've got the SES and you've got the Army out there helping them. But soon enough, this is going to hit all of us because this is the food bowl of Australia. And so if all of the food gets destroyed, then it has an impact on the price that we pay at the supermarket. I suspect that you know, Australians are going to be as sick of La Nina as they were of COVID, and we're going to really feel this over the next few months.
There are huge pressures on budgets at the moment, Scott, and I fear over the next 6 months a lot are going to be right on the edge.
Oh, look, no doubt about that, Carl. We've got the budget next week coming down by Jim Chalmers. And this is only going to add to the inflationary pressures. We know the inflationary pressures then add to the interest rates with the RBA. So, look, a lot of Australians are going to be doing it tough, and they're going to be looking at next week's budget and saying, what's in it for me? What's in it to help me get through the next couple of years with all these pressure?
And given that, Jason, you've seen what's happened to the British PM with her promised tax cuts. I mean, she's in all sorts of trouble now. Do you really think it's still a good idea, given the state of the economy, to press ahead with those Tier 3?
Well, Carl, I think you'll have Jim on in a couple of minutes talking about the budget that, as Scott said, is due next week. I just make the general point, you know, what's that saying? If it, you know, doesn't rain, it pours. We're seeing that in the economy as well. Inflation, interest rates, now this, it's just going to make it harder for Aussies. Things are going to get harder before they get better, and we've got to focus on that as we put the budget together for next week.
So it sounds like you're pulling out of the tax cuts.
No. We've made it clear. I think the boss said it, Jim said it last week, that we're not, haven't changed our plans. But what we've got to do is build a budget for the times, and that's what we're doing.
Welcome back to the show. Financial reality check for parents this morning with the true cost of childcare laid bare.
It comes as a hidden flaw in the paid parental leave scheme is exposed. And for more, we're joined by today money expert Effie Zahos. Before we get to that flaw, just explain how much parents are currently spending on childcare.
Yeah, so some new data's come out by KindyCare, and it just shows that the cost of long day care keeps escalating. Mm. I mean, I remember when I had my kid in long day care, it was $70. It's completely different now. On average, it's about $123 nationally. Whoa. But you can see here, ACT is the most expensive at $133, and the most affordable is there at Tassie at $106.
Why is it so expensive in the ACT? Is it just
couple of factors of what's happening. So what this data shows is that on average, prices have gone up by 6 to 8%. Some of them have gone up by as much as 14%.
And they're still on the rise?
So, yeah, they're still on the rise. So why are those states more expensive than others? Two factors. Comes down to, basically, the labour shortages and the cost of getting them in there, and also the cost of renting premises. So when you look at labour shortages, you've got some states like Victoria that are paying up to $50,000 as incentives to get staff there. And those buildings, those childcare centres that don't own their building, they're vulnerable to paying their lease, their rent, and that's now tiered to that CPI.
So is there a leaf out there?
Well, Ali, there's a lot happening in the headlines now. So the childcare subsidy is one. That's being tweaked, as we know. So next year, that will give more relief. This is not until July next year. The threshold will increase from what, that $72,000 to up to $80,000. So if you're earning under $80,000, your subsidy, your rebate will go up by 90%. Up to 90%. You'll still get a subsidy if you earn over $80,000. It just tapers down, but they've increased that threshold now to $530,000. You can earn up to $530,000 before you get zero. So that is something to be looking at.
Okay, new announcements made for paid parental leave, said to be extended to 26 weeks by 2026, but not everyone's happy with all of that. It's hard. It's a hard sector to have a win in.
It is a hard sector to have a win in, but when you look at how payments are made, sometimes they're actually pegged to the household income, other times they're pegged to individually. The big issue here is I don't think anybody's not agreeing that this is great going from 18 to 26, but the thing is it's pegged on the female's salary. So it's not a household salary. So there's discrimination there in the sense that if a woman earns over $156,000, regardless of whether she's the main bread earner or she, you know, is with a millionaire and so on, it's not fair pegging it to the woman's income. It needs to be as a household. So I'll give you an example. I could be earning under $156,000, married to James Packer, and I'd be eligible for it. Then another one, Ali, could be earning just a little bit over it. She's the main breadwinner and doesn't get it.
Let's go back to you being married to James Packer.
One can only dream.
He is available, from what I hear.
Oh, I might be out of his league.
But is it,
I think I'm married.
Oh, wow.
Oh, hang on. He doesn't need another scandal.
No, he don't. I don't need a scandal. I'm happily married.
He's happy too. Good on you. Thank you, Effie.
Thanks, Effie.